Test, hello. Test, 1, 2. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Hello, hello, hello.
Hello, everybody. Do you hear me? Yeah? So, do you hear me? It's cool? Yeah, okay, thank you. Oh. Picture, it's normal or not? Yeah, it changed resolution, so I think it's detecting the video projector, but maybe it's not. Okay, that's nice, thank you. I'm sorry, it's not a Mac. Everybody is using a Mac, yeah? So I will be a little bit less lost. Oh, maybe we'll see. But indeed, it's first time I use the awful Microsoft OXPS file, so I even don't know what I'm doing. So, yeah, it starts. It works. Welcome to this workshop. It's about OSL. It will be a little bit hard sometimes. I hope if you have question, you will have time to ask question after, but if you are completely lost, just ask, and I will make a pause. Okay. So I'm François Gastaldo. I'm teacher. I'm teaching shading writing. Surely some of you saw my video on Vimeo about what I did with my students in shading writing. I choose to teach OSL because it's, I think, the most interesting shading language for a long time. And it's easier also. So let's start with compatibility. Why this conference? In fact, OSL was a nice project, and Blender was near the first to adopt it, really. And so we have a huge knowledge about OSL, and this year OSL spread everywhere in computer graphic, and it's promised to be the number one shading language. So it's a very good thing to think about using our knowledge and adapt it to everything. And so what we will study at first at okay. Yes. At first we'll have a small reminder about what is a shading language. It could be useful. What is the difference between renderers? Some case studies about texture and materials. And after, we will talk about the OSL pipeline, how to integrate OSL in pipeline. And then at the end, here, number 6, you could ask many questions. Okay? So, first, what is a shading language? Yeah, shading language is a nice way to make materials. Easier than nodes, not so easier, in fact. Just a shader is made to have exactly the look of the object you want. That's the first part. The second part is to be able to have this shader in your production, and anyone could use it without having unexpected result. Most people are working a lot on this first part, the right look, and forgot this one with 10,000 parameters to tweak. A good shader must have a good user interface. So anyone in the production can use it. So, yeah, the OSL is not the number one, and it's not the only one shading language in the world. You surely heard about GLSL for OpenGL. You heard about MetaSL from Mantelray. It was a really nice idea, but unfortunately there were no documentation, so we couldn't do anything with it. RSL is the first advanced high-level shading language ever existing. It started in 1985, so long time ago, 30 years of RSL. And OSL is mainly derived from this language. It's a simplified version of RSL. There is a lot of other shading language we will not talk about. What makes OSL so specific and so different than all this language, in fact? So let's start with the spreadsheet. I really love spreadsheet. Yeah, spreadsheet. I really love that. What we can see here is that, okay, there is just few language. OSL is the only one that works without a light loop. What it means? That you can control how the light is applied to your object with OSL. And you let the renderer do. So the renderer can do anything he wants. And that's the main interest of OSL. It's that very, very specific to your renderer. And so you get the most of your renderer. With all other languages like GLSL or RSL, you have render-independent shading language. You write a shader, and it gives you the same pixel for every renderer. So if your renderer is really top nice with SSS and so on, you can't have it. So so it's really limited. You can do really nice things, but if you want to have multi-renderer in your production, use, for example, Mantra for volume and Apple Seed for global illumination, you can't use such language because you will not be able to take advantage of why you are choose this renderer. That's why OSL is now going everywhere, just because of this. The main problem with that is that it's not made for having a common shading language between renderers. So OSL is not made for compatibility. So, okay, why is this conference? Why is this workshop? In fact, the main object of OSL was to have a common framework. Unique language, whatever is your renderer. It can be Ampere, Ampere, Ampere renderer. It could be very photorealistic renderer using the same language. So you don't have to relearn a new language each time you are doing shading. And also, it's open source project. So it's easier to put a shading language in your renderer with open shading language. And that's a big thing, because it's really open source, and it seems that it's really nicely done, because a lot of people adopt it now. So using for compatibility between renderer, using OSL for making the same shading between renderer, is kind of very dangerous, very dangerous way. What you are going to do is not exactly what you want to do. So, when you hit render in V-Ray and you hit render in Cycles, even if there is the same shader, you will not have the same result. So it's nice to have common framework to take advantage of each renderer, but if you have put too much trust in OSL, you will slip and and fall, surely. And so, OSL, I said it, spread completely the CG world last year, in fact, this year, 2014. 2 years ago, it was just Cycles and Arnold at Sony Pictures and Spectral Studio and Autodesk Bisque. It was four. Now there is a lot of more, as you can see. The one in orange, yellow, orange, it's the one I use in this presentation. And there is more every day, in fact, like XRT, which opened to Open Shading Language just last week. And there is some strange renderer like Paprika. Everyone know Paprika here? Yeah. No, nobody know, and nobody use it. It's open source NPR, so non-photorealistic renderer. Apple Seed, I discovered it not so long time ago, and it's really, really nice. And also on internal studio renderer, like Ubisoft for the, I don't know how to say Lapin Crétin in English, So, okay, someone know? No? Yeah, that's it. So they made their own renderer using OSL. Oh, and of course, Arnold in Sony Picture. It was the first one. There's many, many rumors. I will not tell it then about the future. So let's start. OSL implementation differences between renderer. Yes, what's the difference between OSL in Cycles, the difference between OSL in V-Ray, the difference between OSL in others? There is many, many differences. We can have a nice spreadsheet. Yeah, I love that. So, first, how to use it inside the software. Second, what can it do? So, how to use it inside the software? As you can see, you must pre-compile. It's not real compilation, it's pre-compile in an OSL shader. Apple Seed is not able to pre-compile, so you have to use an external software to pre-compile. Once you have your shader, you have to use it. And it's not so easy, in fact. I discovered that some things like Spectra Studio or Apple Seed doesn't have Node Editor. So you have a shader, but you can't branch it to another shader. So it completely limits what you can do in a shader. It has to be a closed shader. And there is very, very few software that is that allow to compile, to pre-compile inside the software, to edit inside the software, and also to have external files. There is just one who is doing everything. And with the latest OSL specification, V-Ray is on 1.3 specification, and in fact, Blender is 1.49. It's near 1.5, it's just one closure difference. So, microfacet. And Spectral Studio, there is no documentation about what specification, so you have to, okay, to try to find which one. So, now, okay, you already know this, okay? That's the only one which is doing everything. It's Blender. So I think that for if you want to do OSL shading, it's really nice to start with Blender and then adapt it to other software. Second limitation is not the way it is used in the software. It's interface limitation. It was big, big surprise when I start to use many, many renderers to see that having input of renderer, it's not so obvious. When you have a shader in Cycles, you have input and output. If you are working with Apple Seed, you have no output. No output. Yes, so you have to use the standard TI closure. So it makes an output. And things like that. So it's the interface, really. The shader is working, but the output and the input are not the same. So another spreadsheet, yes? Yeah, another spreadsheet. Love that. For example, the metadata, the famous metadata you ask every year at the Blender Conf, are available only in Spectra Studio and very, very, very limited version in V-Ray. So in V-Ray, the only thing you can do in metadata is to have a check mark. Yes, no. That's better than 0-1 in Blender. But indeed, in V-Ray, you have just color input. If you want a vector input, a floating point input, a parameter input, you can't have it. So it's very, very limited. I was thinking that V-Ray for Maya will go a little bit farther, but no, just color input also. Except that in V-Ray for Maya, you can make script in input, but it's not shading. What's interesting about Apple Seed, it's all XML software. So you can have everything, include nodes, connecting nodes, and so on, but by script. So if you like scripting, if you have a nice TD in your production which loves scripting, it's a good product. Even if there is just one output, it's CI, as you can see. Other things, okay. Well, yeah.
What is CI?
CI is standard closure output. So when you write a shader, it has one output by default. It's CI. If you write to the variable CI, then the renderer is able to read this output. Indeed, it doesn't work in Blender.
Actually, in Cycles, the output node that you have at the end is passing it to CI.
Okay.
So we cannot use it elsewhere because the output node is passing it to CI. So when you connect this, the surface or volume shader, then passes it to the CI output.
Oh, so it's nice. So it exists. Indeed, yes, we will see after. When you are writing a shader for V-Ray and for Blender, you have to put the CI if you want it to work very well. So next step. One good news is that all those limitations are the only one if you are not using Clojure. What we call texture shader is just changing the color, mostly, like a checker and so on. If you are doing such a geometric and a texture shader, there is no other limitation. And you can have your script with just color output, compile it with Blender and use it in Apple Seed, for example. It works very well. If you are using in V-Ray, it's not the same OSL specification. So you will have a nice V-Ray crash. Really nice and fast. So, and but indeed, if you copy past the code, it works very well. But yes, a little but, what it is. But there is some other limitation which are just the import-export of the scene, like size change. Yes, if you have a 10 sense size, 10 times bigger in one render and another, your checker will be 10 times smaller in the final render. So it's not nice. One stupid thing, it's a Y-up, Z-up. It's really stupid, but you will have your shader just... UV input, it's also a nice surprise. It works. The U and V variable working very well with V-Ray and not very well with Blender. I didn't have to them working. So I have to put a UV input in Blender. Indeed, Blender is well known because you can have as many UV as you want in one object. So what is UV variable in this case? So... And also inverted normal, everyone knows that normal are not in the same direction in Cycles and in V-Ray. No, nobody knows. Yeah, it's just the opposite. So you will have a nightmare on all your glass and so on. And so there is solution, of course. But if you take a shader, you have your Blender shader, nice, it's working, and you just use it in V-Ray on Apple Seed, here what you have. So the original one in Cycle, yeah, it works. The one with V-Ray, as you can see, there is a huge size change and all triangles are so small they are not visible. And in Apple Seed, it's just the opposite. Huge triangle. So how to take care of this? Just you have the right to make photos if you want. This, because if you have to write it, it's not so easy. So here are the solution to make shader, texture shader working between Cycles and others. First, use absolute value of the normal. Just something stupid, but so you will not have inverted normal. Indeed, it's not so easy to say if we're front face or back face. So it's, okay, it works if you don't want to have a different shader on front face and on back face. Second, never use the P variable alone because there is the biggest change between renderer. So I have on my scene, on my shaders, a size factor which compensates the size difference, like one is working in each, one in centimeters. Yes, that's really nice. And also I use standard transform to have an object space P. P is position of object, of the pixel. So the transform object is at two main advantages. The first one is that it's local P, so it's the same between renderer. The second one is when your object is moving, your texture is moving with it. If you are in the world P, when your object is moving, your texture is not moving. So it's a kind of special effect, really nice for clouds. And to invert z and y, just invert z and y, you can see here. There is more, of course. There is a way to have this automatized by the precompiler and with an external file. I call it who I am, okay? Do not do this on Unix because it's a Unix instruction. So I say what is the renderer and the size factor, and then I apply it. Okay. Usually I don't use it because I'm compiling shader as far as possible, as it's possible, in Blender. So it's always Blender or cycles. So I don't use it so much. Wait, yes? Yes, and worst of all is 3ds Max, where you can change this in the software. You can have the same software and put it in inch or in centimeters. And if you do that, just what you have in P change, but not your scene in the interface. So yes, it's very nice for architect to have to work in millimeters or in kilometers, but what we are doing. So. And that's why I have this size factor. It's very, very important. And that's why it's exactly 1 inch in this case, as you can see. So it's a not so big limitation, I think. So it's easy to have an interface and write it. So what it does, as you can see, the result is really much, much better. Just applying the things, and now if I remove the name, you have to tell which one is which one. There is just one difference, it's the noise size on Appleseed, which is not the same, I don't know why. But it's not so visible, okay? So for texture shading, it's perfect, you can have really exactly the same if you follow those really simple rules. I'm really happy with this picture. The second case is when we are not doing texture material, texture shader, but material shader, using closures. When you are using closures, so you are writing directly to the renderer and have a very, very specific rendering. So closure, the hard work begins, yes. Each closure are different. Each closure are different, even if it has the same name, it's not exactly the same between renderers. When you are doing a diffuse closure, it could be not a diffuse, the same source of diffuse for V-Ray or for cycles. So you will not have the same result. So it's very dangerous to work with it. Yes. That's what I said. Yeah. And other thing also, usually the inputs could be different, like the roughness. The roughness of microfacet, there is some offset sometimes, or factor, so you have to find it. And so there is two ways to work with closures. The first way is to say, okay, I'm going in documentation. In fact, when you are working with OSL, you are going in documentation very, very, very often, about 2 minutes. Every 2 minutes, you are reading the documentation, and you try to find which closure are working on every renderer. And so, the first strategy, you use only common closure, the one you can find on every renderer. If it works, you can share the precompiled file. It works very well between, for example, cycles and Appleseed. You make a shader using just diffuse, for example, and you precompile it in Blender. You take the .oso file and use it in Appleseed. It works perfectly. Indeed, there is really a small number of common closures. So if you want very specific things, you have to do it yourself. So you have to develop more and write bigger shader. And bigger shader means slower shader, and so on. And even like this, you can have any guarantee of the same result. So let's try indeed. This is the second solution. Oops. Okay. The second solution is do not use common closure and just adapt yourself to every renderer. I like this one, but there is a lot of work because you have to make correspondence between Clojure. What Clojure with such inputs is doing compared to what other, to another one. So there is a hard work to do here. So let's try the first one with a spreadsheet. Yeah. So here are the common Clojure from the OSL specification. Not all. I didn't talk about volume Clojure. I didn't talk about subsurface Clojure. Mostly they came from Blender, so it's not a problem. What we can see is that there is only four common Clojure. Things like Phong are not in Cycles. Oh, Phong is not in Cycles. It's a good thing. Nobody uses it. But it's the main Clojure in V-Ray. There is some difference between 1.5 on microfacet. Blender is still using microfacet from 1.4, and 1.5 changed the way to write microfacet. It's a not so good change. And a big mistake about Oren Nayar, because on the first documentation they forgot this underline. And so everybody is using Oren Nayar like this. And so you can't use the same. It's just a stupid thing. And so if I want to make a nice example, I wrote something that make old metal, a simple shader with broad reflection and doing old metal. So here is the shader. As you can see, it's a little bit long for doing exactly the same as microfacet, but a little less perfect. And so here are the result on the cycles. As you can see, there is roof reflection and a diffuse component, and it can also do a nice reflection if you put roof net to zero. It's a very, very simple scene. So let's try it, as it's the same, and the same Clojure. Let's try it on another renderer in Appleseed. Work nice. I like Appleseed. A nice open source project. And let's try it on V-Ray. Fail. So, yeah. Now, what happened? In fact, I was using N perturbation to make the broad reflection. But in V-Ray, you can't change normal with your shader. So, as I'm using changing normal, it doesn't work at all. And I have just a nice reflection, not blurry at all. So, as you can say, as I said before, even with the same Clojure, you could have very, very different results. So I think that using the same Clojure is very okay. It's easier because you don't have to think about what Clojure could be in the next one. But there is some danger. Indeed, if you are just using diffuse, it's okay. If you are using emission, even emission, yes. Even emission sometimes is missing. No, even for making a light source, it's not so easy to use common Clojure. So it failed. So what we have to do? First thing is, though, the limitation, I already talked about that, is using specific Clojure. So specific Clojure, you have to read the documentation and find, I want to make some roughness on reflection, how to do it. Okay, I find microfacet Beckman, for example, in Cycle. I find microfacet in Appleseed, and I find Phong in V-Ray. And so, and I find a lot of things. And as you can see on different renderer, of course, Cycle has a lot of Clojure. It's because it's open source, it's well known, so a lot of people are working with it. A lot of people are asking for Clojure, and some people are programming other Clojure. So we have really a lot. On V-Ray, it's okay, it's just 6 months of OSL, so there is not a lot, and not the best, like Blin. Who cares about Blin now? Appleseed is really nice because it has a Disney material definition, which is a very, very nice way to have physically based material. So next in Cycles, no? Yeah, maybe. It's open source. So, and Spectral Studio, which is not well known, they're the same as Blender, but they stopped development, so I don't know what happened now. And so, Here are the equivalencies, the chart. You can make photo also, or you can learn it. Yes, okay. In 5 seconds, I will give you a paper, and you'll rewrite it after. Okay. So, as you can see, the same shader, the same closure with the same result could be very difficult, just because the Phong is not working with roughness, but with glossiness. So you have to invert the roughness, and with a two-factor. Nice. So it takes some time to find it. Many tests. Once you have it, it could be really fast. You just have to have this example and copy paste in your shader. But you need to spend some time to find the closure, the correct closure, to read what could do the best and what is the most close to microfacet Beckmann, what is the difference between microfacet Beckmann and GGX. And is GGX possible with Phong? No. So you have a lot of work. I just give you for my example. I start to make a very long file at home with everything different, in fact, like ONIR, roughness of an old ONIR with factor and so on. It works well, but a lot of job. Indeed, you just have to do it once. So if it's for production, it could be nice. One main advantage is that I replace this long shader but this really short one. Indeed, it's too short. Okay, so the result. Blender, yeah, not so big difference. Okay, Appleseed, I start to realize that Appleseed is very, very sensitive to clamping. And I didn't clamp my shader, as you can see, there is no clamp function. And so I have far flies. A lot of far flies. With the difference of color, it's mostly the difference between color profile. I didn't try to tweak color profile between under because it's too much job, too much work to do. So there is difference between luminosity, exposure, and color profile. And with V-Ray, so yes. Is working now and very close to Blender. Oh, it's working nice. So you can do really real shading between V-Ray and Cycle. V-Ray 3. So for me, using specific closure, you spend a lot of time in documentation, a lot of tests, but it's the best result. It's also the faster because the shader are smaller. And easier to write because when you did all your tests and you choose which closure corresponds to which closure, you just have to copy paste. Indeed, it's sometimes impossible. For example, if you want to make subsurface scattering with Appleseed, it's just not possible. So there is no subsurface scattering with Appleseed. So even if you could try to find a closure, you will not find it. If you want to make volume with V-Ray, V-Ray is not making volume with OSL, so you could not. So sometimes it's impossible. But indeed, it's not a big problem, because when you choose your renderer, you choose it for one reason. For example, volume or so on. You want to have an architectural with V-Ray on 3ds Max and volume made with Cycle, because they are very, very powerful. Then you mix the two, and you will not have need of volume in V-Ray. The goal is not to have exactly the same picture, it's to take advantage of each renderer. That's why it's sometimes impossible, it's not so big problem. So now, how to do it? I already said it, so you just have to read. Now, how I'm doing my shading now? Always, as Blender is the best for developing shading, because it's just all internal and so on, I write and debug completely the shader in Blender. Then I think about going elsewhere. Going elsewhere, I export it. I'm using Sublime text editor just because it has OSL pack. Indeed, I have no special feeling for Sublime. It's the OSL pack. There is also OSL pack in the text editor in Blender. It works. And so then, once in Sublime, I save one shader per renderer with specific closure. So if you use four or three renderers, you have to have three or four shaders. each one with specific closure. And if you make a mistake, you will have a lot of error in your renderer. Like you save a V-Ray and you open it in a cycle. So be careful. Then I precompile, and mostly I try to use the OZO file instead of the OSL file. So I have just one OSL file. OSL file is safe. On the production, I do not give the OSL file, so nobody is tempted to write in it. So the OZO file is secure. So I have the OZO file in my project. Okay. Everybody knows SLC? No, in fact, nobody knows, just because in Blender you don't need it. So, but when you are using V-Ray or AppleSeed, sometimes you need to compile with OSLC, which is a nice DOS command. Yes, wow. And it should work. If you do this, it works about every time. About. Which means that you have to read the documentation and read the documentation, because there is no software with all OSL specification in it. Even Cycles doesn't have missing feature, and it's normal. It's OSL is not made to have exactly the same thing on every renderer. So the first shader I made with V-Ray was an ambient occlusion, three-color ambient occlusion. Some of you are using this. And one ambient occlusion in red, one in blue, one in green. And so with one render, you have three ambient occlusions for compositing. And it's nice, but it I fall on this one. Message passing are not implemented, so I could not retry the length of the ray. So as you can see, you have to read the documentation and be very, very careful of what you are doing. There is some limitations that you will not discover until you are trying to do it. There is no such things in Blender documentation. It's a pity. Like what we are not doing. I know there is a lot of job for writing documentation. So now, okay. Yes. What about working in a production with many renderers and using 100% OSL? I think it's a good thing, because you don't have to think about how to do materials, how to do texture every time. You have just one way to do it and then adapt. So here again, you have many ways to make this. The first thing is Uber shader, the famous Uber shader. You are making one shader doing everything. Yes. What is nice is that you are doing one shader. And then you have just set, click on reflection if you want to have reflection, transparency if you have transparency, and so on. The main problem is that each renderer will have different result. And when you export your scene, you will not export the material. If you are using FBX, or things like that, or Alembic, you will not export your shader setting. So if you have 1,000 materials, no, I know it's a lot, less than 10 materials, you will have to set one by one by hand on the upper shader on each renderer. This object is blue, this object is red, and so on. So you have one shader, less shader programming, less shader developing, but more work. But indeed, it's my personal point of view, okay? Indeed, in many production or in studios, the best way to solve a problem is to give it to next step. So I solve the shading problem, you solve the material problem, okay? I am shader writing, I'm not doing texture and material, so it's your problem now, I made a nice over shader. Okay, it's a... Everybody who work in big studio know that, and that's why people in compositing have a lot of things to do, because they are the last one. Okay, the second way to work is to have one shader per object or per material you want. With inside this shader, you will have all the settings. You can even have no interface. So you are doing the shading and the materials and the texture. Then you have a closed shader, and you just have to load it in your renderer. So there is no possibility of error. No people will make a strange setting, and you will do the job just once. And you will have no UI problem, like you could have between Visual and Cycle, because you have no UI. What could be the problem? A lot of shading development. You have to make all the job, it's not funny. And just-in-time compilation. You know that OSL is just-in-time compilation. Yes, surely. If you have 1,000 or 10,000 shaders, it can start to be slow. And you can have 3-5 minutes of just-in-time compilation for 10,000 shaders. But indeed, when you have 10,000 shaders in one scene, surely you are not aware about 1 or 2 minutes more. It's a very, very big scene. So if you have 6 hour rendering, having 2 minutes more, it's not a big problem. One very big default also is here, possibility to cheat. You close every possibility to cheat. If your blue is too blue because of color profile before, because of anything, you can change it. So me, I'm using a mix of the two. Some objects are over shading. Some other have very, very specific shading. So let's start with a nice example of what we can do. Yes, so it's a scene for my DST render, which is a closed website now, so you will not find it. And this scene is 100% OSL, even the light. The light are OSL. There is no light in this scene, just luminous object. So it's a Blender render, a Cycle render. As you can see, it's not so bad. It's really, really good. And so it's a reference. There is one problem, but it's my export that didn't work well. I lose the smoothing group here, so there is black things, so I have to correct it. And it works. So what about AppleSeed? For AppleSeed, I do just say, here's the result. This time I didn't understand yet the clamping problem. So there is Farfly a little bit everywhere. As you can see, the color profile is not the same. The camera is not the same. It's my mistake. I didn't saw that film size in AppleSeed is 33, 36, or 34. Something like that, and not 36. So I have a smaller field of view. And otherwise, it's working very well. As both are in Beckman, microfacet Beckman, we have the same specular, we have the same shading, it's a little bit darker. There is no compositing, just this root rendering. In compositing, you can have just the same rendering and the same contrast and color. And V-Ray. V-Ray is really close in lighting to Blender. Really, really close. So I adapt, and it's Phong. So Phong is not Beckman. And we have a perfectly round specular. I really don't like it. Indeed, it works very well, and all shading, even color, checker, and are just the same between renderer. And if I do something, and I need a part of one shader, one renderer, not other, it works very well. So this scene is a good start, and you can say, yes, it's really, really possible to work with many renderers. The second scene I made, it's a kind of nightmare for every renderer. And it's really extreme. And so here it is. Yeah. The sun coming in a near full global illumination scene. So it's a nightmare because there is a lot of computation needed. And so with Blender and Cycles, this render time was about 25 hours. And I have a lot of little far flies. Far flies come from one thing. There is near 1,000 luminous objects. And it's very, very difficult for a near underwater to find the 1,000 luminous object and make the correct lighting. And sometimes you, oh, I found one luminous object, that's nice. But otherwise there is a sun so much bigger. And so it makes a lot of problem. The biggest surprise was Appleseed, with exactly the same shader, it's common shader. Appleseed is about 20 minutes. And yeah. What happened to Appleseed? I don't know. I have some normal problem. As you can see, there is some black parts, so I have some normal problem. I have some Fresnel problem due to normal problem, because you have a very mirror things in a glass. So it's due to my normal problem. I every time outside of glass and not inside. But indeed, I don't know how they did that. It's just I click render because I was phoning, and when I came back, it was perfect. Whoa, what happened? So now with the V-Ray, okay. Who likes V-Ray here? Nobody likes V-Ray? Yeah? You will be very decisive. V-Ray! V-Ray, what happened to V-Ray? V-Ray is with 3ds Max, and color profile in 3ds Max is just a nightmare, and it doesn't work at all. And so you can see the nice color of V-Ray, and that's not the only problem. There is this white line. What is this white line? I don't know. Render error. Now, as you can see in Appleseed, I correct my clamping problems. There is no more far fly. Okay. But in V-Ray, I try everything I can, and there is this rendering error. I don't know why. Luminous objects are not so luminous. Why not? But this is luminous part. I didn't want. On this object also, just like I put neon or inverted ambient occlusion on object, I don't know what happened. So I decide to get rid of problem of color profile problem and to try V-Ray for Maya. So it's the same renderer. Yeah, and yes, color profile makes a very, very big difference. And without nice color profile, and with a correct color profile. Indeed, I lose all my luminous object. So, nobody's perfect. You can have luminous object in V-Ray with bugs, and you can have no luminous object with V-Ray with Maya. But indeed, the result is nice because we have a common framework, we have the same shading. If I want to put here in middle an object I made with Cycles with Blender and render it with Blender because of smoke and so on and reflection, I can render everything with the set with Appleseed or with V-Ray and render just the character with the smoke in Cycle and make a nice compositing because it's the same lighting and it's the same thing. So we can mix a lot of renderer like that. In Gravity, they use Arnold, they use Mantra, and they use Clarisse on the same picture. And and so now with OSL, it's possible to do this atom only atom. So it's very nice picture. I think that it opened many doors. And if you find one shader, one renderer doing really things you need at the correct render time, you can mix the renderer using OSL. Unfortunately, it's not OSL everywhere. So now we are near the end. I think, I don't know if I was too fast or too slow. There is no clock here. Yes, it's time to use your cell phone camera. So some useful links include one for the 3D scene I use, but it's done, it doesn't work anymore. I use some shader from not in this page. Spectral Studio, Spectral Pixel, Spectral Studio is not available anymore. So just a button download soon for 6 months. So it's really far soon. But I hope it will come back because it's the only one with OSL and GPU. And it's very, very interesting. Indeed, I didn't show result with Spectral Studio just because each time I hit render in my computer, I come back on a nice BIOS boot. So I didn't try anymore after 2 or 3 reboot. Okay, it's okay. I will not use Spectral Studio. So I think I don't know why, in fact. Maybe it's my window version. I don't know why. What is interesting is the OSL specification. If you want to work with OSL, it's the first file to download, the documentation. There is everything in it. I tell it a lot. So it's the end. I want to thank some people, our greats, who really helped me on this course. He's really nice man and doing really, really nice job and really open to any discussion. Of course, all cycle team and Blender, of course. But okay, too many thanks in 3 days. It's not so good. Michel Anders, Michael Anders, maybe I make a mistake, was writing a nice book about learning OSL. And I use some of this shader. And of course, OSL community, people who helped me, people who I didn't write it as a, don't remember his name, who write OSL for Corona. So there is no Corona here because it's just a small part of OSL now, people and so on. So the main programmer of Apple Seed and so on. We had a lot of mail about how it works and the clamping problem and so on. And so if you have question, yeah.
I'm not familiar with that much shading stuff. So could you tell me what's the performance of, say, OSL versus GLSL? Would you use OSL for a game engine, for example?
OSL is not for real time. It's really not optimized for real time. And OSL give something to it for the renderer. GLSL is computing a pixel. So it's perfect for real time. What you want is a fast result. For OSL, it's really to make shading for production to take care about what the renderer can do. A GLSL is to go as fast as possible, and so it's up to you to optimize.
Okay, thank you.
And also, GLSL, it's mid-level, it's not low-level language, but it's mid-level. You have to take care about a lot of things, about how your graphic card is working and so on, if you want to make really pure GLSL. OSL is very, very high level, it's stratospheric level of language. It's just shading for dummies sometimes. Any other question?
Yes, hello. If I'm new to renderers and I want to use one, why should I? What's the benefit of understanding OSL to choose between every all of them? Why can I stay to one?
So there is different case we need shading. If you are doing a very short project, like for TV, and it's 4 o'clock and you need the animation at 2 o'clock, it's really specific from TV for TV, you will not have time to do shading. If you are on longer project and you need a uniformity between your object, you need all object to have the same look, and do not write every time a new shader or to make a new material every time. You need also have a common easier way. For example, if you are doing paper characters, you will write a specific paper shader. So with interesting feature like is a grid paper, it's a paper with hole, and so on, very, very specific. And so when you use it, you are thinking about paper and not about, okay, I need 30% of diffusion, I need 1% of reflection, and so on. This is in the shader, you think about it just once, and after you just have to use it. So you lose a little bit time to make specific shading, but after, in the production, if you have a lot of object, you gain a lot of time because you are just working in the way artists want to work. You have shading for artists. Also, you can have a very specific look. Sometimes in the renderer, you could maybe have this look with node 3 with a 100 node. But and I did it with 100 node. I made some render tree in Softimage was about 200 nodes. The same shader I released it for Blender 2 years ago on OSL is about 20 lines. So nodes are nice to make fast things, but not complex things. When you are writing shader, if you want to multiply plus and take care about clamping and so on, it's just one line. You don't have to make one node after one node after one node. For example, if you want to make SSS, subsurface scattering, mostly you don't know what color to do to make on subsurface scattering. It's the main problem. Everybody knows this problem. Okay, I have a blue candle, but what is the color of subsurface scattering? In fact, there is an equation to find it. If you diffuse the blue, so there is not the blue inside. And subsurface scattering is not the blue. So red and green. That's why when you have a blue candle and you write it, you have a kind of orange color. Yeah, nobody tries this. Okay. And you can make this little thing in OSL really fast. And so if you have, everybody saw Sucker Punch with this nice shot with 10,000 of candles, all in 3D. but how to make all candles different? How to make all candles physically correct? By hand, you will spend your life to do it. If you write a shader doing a candle with a noise changing each candle, you just take all candles, assign this shader, you spend one day to write it, but you save 10,000 days assigning materials. So that's a main interest in shading. Yes.
I have a small question about a GPU and the fact that it doesn't run on GPU, and will it be possible to run it on GPU later, and if I don't think so, and how does the studio think about OSL, about the fact that it doesn't run on GPU? You will gain time on the pipeline doing this using OSL, but maybe lose on the speed of rendering. What is the future of OSL on this topic?
Oh, there's a lot of question in one question. So at first, the GPU. Larry Gritz is aware of this problem, so he's working on it. Maybe he said in 1.7, so so not 1.6, but maybe in one OSL 1.7, it will be GPU. OSL is using LLVM, which is a pre-compiler, and LLVM works a little bit wired with GPU. Some people say yes, we can; others no. So I don't know what is the truth about that. And so actually, there is no GPU for OSL just now. Maybe in future. Indeed, Spectral Studio made their own version of OSL with GPU. Okay, it crashed my computer, but they did it. The problem after the problem in production, not a lot of production rely on GPU render. GPU render has a lot of problem, mainly because there is a new graphic card every 2 months. This graphic card, when you launch a render on it, doesn't give the same result. So if you have a long production with 6 months of computation, it's not so good. Second thing, Intel, it's not so bad. Really not so bad. And if you are doing correct way of programming your shader, even in OSL, we we show one example given by Pixar on OSL shading, just by correct programming of the OSL shader using Intel recommendation, the OSL shader was about 15 times faster. So faster than GPU. Wow.
It was more, it's an advantage to use OSL. Maybe it will kill the GPU, GPU usage.
GPU is useful. Really, GPU is useful. I think that when you are doing pre-visualization, it's really, really useful. But when you are planning on 2 hours of rendering per frame, GPU is not a so big advantage. So because there is memory limitation, you can have 64 gigabyte of memory on GPU and so on. So it's a little bit... who is using OSL and who is not using OSL? And OSL is in development step. 2 years ago, when Cycle decided to choose OSL, it was a very, very big bet. Will it work? Will people will like it? And it was a very, very good choice at the end. Because RSL is near dead. The previously the random shading language is not enough powerful. As I write it, RSL is not enough powerful. There is problem with not connectivity. There is problem with if you want to take care about what your render can do. If you have a strong path tracing, RSL is not so good. So there is a need of a new shading language taking advantage of advanced rendering. And OSL is here for this. So more and more studios are using OSL. But it's on the growing step. It's growing. Now we know that if you are going to see the next Pixar film next year, it's 100% OSL. So it's finished. OK, so it's finished. Thank you. Welcome. Oh, it was short. Thank you. Why is there a problem? Yes, there is a problem. Oh, really? Oh, I was lucky. Yes. Thank you.
Are you set the configuration. Thank you.
just want to mirror. Yeah. Just fine. Just next one. Second one. Fine.
Sound doesn't seem to be working.
No, it's fine.